is the kingdom and the power and the glory of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. I'm ready to
scourges and my sorrows continually before me. For I will declare my iniquity, and I will take heed concerning my sin. My enemies live and are made stronger than I, and they that hate me unjustly are multiplied. They that render me evil for good slander me, because I pursue goodness. Forsake me not, O Lord my God, depart not from me. Be attentive unto my help, O Lord, my salvation. Forsake me not, O Lord my God, depart not from me. Be attentive unto my help, O Lord, my salvation. O God, my God, unto thee I rise early at dawn. My soul hath thirst before thee. How often hath my flesh longed after thee, in land barren, and untrodden, and in water. So in the sanctuary have I appeared before thee to see thy power and thy glory. For thy mercy is better than lives, my lips shall praise thee. So shall I bless thee in my life, and in thy name will I lift up my hands. As with barren fatness let my soul be filled, and with lips rejoicing shall my mouth praise thee. If I remember thee in my bed, at the dawn I meditated on thee. For thou art become my helper, and the shelter of thy wings will I rejoice. My soul hath cleaved after thee, my right hand hath been quick to help me. But as for these in vain have they sought after my soul, they shall go into the nethermost parts of the earth. They shall be surrendered unto the edge of the sword, portions for foxes shall be thee. But the king shall be glad in God, that everyone shall be praised that sweareth by him. For the mouth of them to stop that speak unjust things. At the dawn I meditated on thee, for thou art become my helper. In the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice. My soul hath cleaved after thee, thy right hand hath been quick to help me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, for now and ever, and to ages and ages. Amen. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, 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 glory to thee, O God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord, now and ever into ages of ages, amen. O Lord, God, my salvation, my day, my pride, my night before thee, let my prayer come before thee, thy God, my nourish my supplication. For filled with evil is my soul, my life, and faith is my mind. And the time of them that go down into the pit, I've been covered with them. Without help, free among the dead, like the bodies of the slain that sleep in the grave. When thou rememberest the Lord, they are far from thy head. In the name of the Lord, in the darkness and shadow of death, against me is my anger and fun, and all thy bills have come out upon me. Thou hast removed my friends apart from me, their name is the abomination of themselves. I have been delivered out of them, not before. My eyes grow weak from poverty, I have cried to thee, O Lord, all day long, I have stretched out my hands unto thee. Nay, the dead will not work wonders, or shall physicians raise their own, but they can do things unto thee. Nay, shall in the grave tell thy mercy, and know thy truth and thy perfection. Nay, shall I run to the room in that darkness, my righteousness. But as for me, and to thee, O Lord, my pride, and the morning shall my prayer come before thee. Wherefore, O Lord, as I pass with my soul, the things that they away from me. A poor man am I, and the children of my grief, being has been exalted, as humbled and brought in distress. Thy fears have passed upon me, and thy fears have still troubled me. They came round about my water, all day long, they come to be about together. Thou shalt be the far from me, my friend, and danger of my wickedness, because of my misery. O Lord, God, my salvation, my dear, my pride, my night before thee, that my prayer come before thee, thou down my ears. Bless the Lord, my soul, and all that you give me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, and forget not all the gift that you give me. His gracious unto all thy iniquities. Who killeth all thy iniquities, who redeemeth thy life from corruption. Who crowneth thee with mercy and compassion, who filleth thy desire with good things. Thy youth shall be renewed as the eagles. O Lord, come with thee for mercy, and execute the judgment for all the dead are wrong. Give thanks based on the Moses, the son of Israel, the things that he hath done. Compassionate and merciful is the Lord, our suffering, and plenteous in mercy. God, unto thee, I will be angry with you, but unto the children of you will be wrong. God, according to our iniquities, have dealt with us, neither according to our sins, have you rewarded us. For according to the might of God, the Lord, we gave mercy to your veil and lift up here. As far as the east is to the west, so far as you have lived our iniquities from us. Let the Father have compassion on the Son, so the Lord have compassion on the Lord, fear him. For the Lord, wherever we are made, he hath been delivered by us. As for now, the day of his days are as the grass, as the Father will feel, so shall we blossom forth. For the wind is not broken, and the shame of honor, the law of the Lord, and the things thereof. But the mercy of the Lord is for the children of Judah, and to the children of honor that fear him, and his righteousness is upon the sons of Israel. darkness is filled with the long dead, and clearly visible in the morning. Within the high trouble, as invisible as entering the wall, there is a final invasion of heaven. A stretch of open has been as a fish that the other world is met. Quickly, you may alarm us, spirit takes away. Turn not that face away from the less of death that we began to fit. Far from the adversity of the audience, the via of the hope. Far from the control of the wayward and the rock, the fear that will fit my soul. Rescue me from my enemies, O Lord, and we have a sense of refuge. Teach me to do that will that I am a God, that will spiritually lead me along with our enemies. But the name of the Lord, that shall prove me, and my righteousness shall be my soul and affliction. And then thy mercy shall not only destroy my enemies, and I shall cut off that I have my soul from my misery. O Lord, who grant my salvation, and grant me my judgment, my servant. O Lord, who grant my salvation, and grant me my judgment, my servant. And this spirit shall lead me in the light of all things. Lord, the promise is the Holy Spirit. Well, now and ever, praise your name. Alleluia, 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 glory to the God. Alleluia, 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 glory to the God. Alleluia, 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 glory to the God. Or I want to know how to hold the Lord with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In peace from above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for those with faith, reverence, and the fear of God entered therein, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities and foreign forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Josh, Ronnie, Adam, Andrew, Benjamin, Thaddeus, Connor, Skyler, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city and for every city and land, for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those under persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Calling to remembrance our all holy Immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady of souls, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
And thee, O Lord.
For unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen. again in peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Call into remembrance, O Holy Immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theosophos, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Our Lord, teach us actions, wherefore
very happy one. For by divine passion are they ever carried up. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and to ages and ages. Amen. By the Holy Spirit are all creation seen and unseen preserved, the control thereof being in Himself, who is without doubt one of the Trinity.
My soul is accepted out to the honor, rest upon that help of Christ. Let thy raised right hand promise me preserve me from all the seats. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and to ages and ages. Amen. By the Holy Spirit, we speak to the divine Son.
I have been filled with great joy by those who say to me, let us go into the courts of the Lord. Verily I have offered a constant prayer. In the house of David, dread wonders take place, for there is a burning fire consuming every evil mind. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and to ages and ages. Amen. Verily the Holy Spirit is the element of life and its beginning. Through him doth every living thing breathe, as is the Father and his word.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For holy art thou, O God, who rest in the saints, and unto thee we ascribe glory, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Gospel, let us pray to the Lord God.
Mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Wisdom, stand upright. Let us hear the Holy Gospel.
Peace be to all. When Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out 7 demons. She went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept. But when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After this, he appeared in another form to 2 of them as they were walking into the country. And they went back and told the rest, but they did not believe them. Afterward, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they sat at table, and he upbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to the whole creation. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick, and they will recover. So then the Lord, after he had spoken to them, was taken up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word by the signs that attended it. Amen.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
And that we have beheld the resurrection of Christ, let us bow down before the Lord Jesus, and let us sing a song. Thy cross we adore, O Christ, and will hold the resurrection with praise and glorify, for thou art our God, and we all know that.
my sin has ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil before thee. But thou mightest be justified in thy words and prevail from the hour of judgment. For behold, I was conceived in iniquities and sin with my mother Mary. For behold, thou hast loved truth and hidden in secret things, and thy wisdom hast thou made manifest unto me. Thou shalt sprinkle me with hyssop, and I shall be made clean. Thou shalt wash me, and I shall be made whiter than snow. Thou shalt make me your joy and gladness, the bones that be humble, they shall rejoice. Turn thy face away from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Pray to me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and let thy governing spirit establish me. I shall teach transgressors thy ways, and the ungodly shall turn back to thee. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my final hope. Rejoice in thy righteousness. O Lord, thou shalt open my lips, and my mouth shall declare thy praise. For if thou hast desired sacrifice, I have given it. The former offerings thou shalt not be pleased. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A heart that is broken and humble, God will not despise. Do good, O Lord, and every pleasure is on that, let the walls of Jerusalem be filled up. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with oblation and over God. Then they shall rejoice upon that altar.
Glory to the Lord.
Of all thy saints, we beseech thee, O most merciful Lord,
Hearken to the petitions of us sinners, and have may and have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Hear the very seas and valleys and compassion of that only begotten Son, with whom thou art blessed, together with that all holy good and life giving Spirit, now and ever and to ages of ages.
On September 2nd, the Holy Orthodox Church, we commemorate the holy martyrs Lamas and his parents, martyrs Theodokos and Rufina, and St. Amia, his foster mother. Keen for the faith in the Trinity is Lamas, enduring the keen wound of a sharpened trident. On the 2nd, the vows of Lamas were spilled by a trident. Lamas was born in Pamplagonia of renowned Christian parents, Theodokos and Rufina. They were cast in prison for the same. His father died first in prison, and as soon as Rufina bore Lamas, she also died. However, God sent an angel to a noble widow, Amia. In a dream, he told her to go to the prison. A local eparch granted Amia permission to bury the dead and to take the child to her home. In school, Lamas displayed unusual intelligence. As he had been reared in a Christian spirit, he did not hide his faith, but confessed it to the other children. Lamas was 15 years old when he was brought before Emperor Aurelian, who persecuted Christians. The emperor told him to deny Christ. Lamas refused, and so Emperor ordered him to be tortured and killed. But an angel of God saved him and took him to a high mountain near Caesarea, where he lived in solitude and prayer. His persecutors found him and again subjected him to fire and wild beasts. Finally, Lamas was run through with a trident by a pagan priest and martyr, giving his holy soul to God in the year 275. On this day, we also commemorate John, the pastor, patriarch of Constantinople. By the intercessions of thy saints, O Christ God, have mercy upon us and save us. Amen.
Thank you.
the Theotokos, and the Mother of the Light, let us honor and magnify in song.
Amen.
praise God in his sanctuary, praising the firmament of his power. O Lord, thou hast befallen the everlasting gates and broken the sun under the chains. Thou didst rise from the tomb, leaving behind thy trappings and ointments in the grave, in testimony of thy truth, pre-imperial, and this go before into Galilee, O thou who were kept in a cave. Pray therefore are thy great mercies, O in the holy Savior, have mercy upon us.
Praise and force my prayers, praise my point to
and from fear of him we were confident by death. Saying, in truth, the Lord, possessor of great mercy, is risen.
Thank you.
extend your mercy to those who know you.
Lord have mercy.
No
Save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace. Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Trembling down death by death.
mercy upon us and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Always in remembrance of all holy, immaculate, most blessed, and gloriously, the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary. For the head of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Thank you.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For holy art thou, our God, and unto thee we ascribe glory, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever.
And unto ages of ages. Wisdom, attend. Let us hear the Holy Gospel.
Peace be to all.
And to thy spirit.
The reading of the Holy Gospel is according to Saint Matthew. Spoke this parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a marriage feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the marriage feast. But they would not come. Again he sent other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, behold, I have made ready my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves are killed, and everything is ready. Come to this marriage feast. But they made light of it and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. But when the king heard of it, he was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the thoroughfares and invite to the marriage feast as many as you find. And those servants went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. When the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment, and he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. And the king said to the servants, bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. Where men will weep and gnash their teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen.
Glory to thee, O Lord. Glory to thee, O Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Today's gospel lesson tells the story of the king who gave a great wedding banquet for his son that no one wanted to attend, and the indifference of the invited guests toward dishonor, the flimsy, mundane excuses they made, is really astonishing considering the absolute authority over life and death that monarchs possessed in those days. And knowing a king sufficiently, you could find yourself in a very bad spot, as what some did, as we heard in our gospel. In a parallel gospel lesson, it doesn't mention the killing of the servants. It's just a bunch of flimsy excuses. I have bought a new team of oxen. I need to check them out. I have married a wife. You know, things like this. I mean, not this bad excuse to marry a wife. These are just like day-to-day things that people were putting ahead of this very wonderful invitation from the king that he had put so much effort into, killing his oxen and fatted calves and so forth. And people just really had no regard for that, and presumably even their own well-being, since the king could quite easily show his wrath. Were they so dull-minded, or so caught up, and so self-absorbed in just life that they didn't even think to respect their king or even their own well-being? And of course, this is a story about Israel and its final rejection of Messiah because of their indifference. But we could easily sort of say it's a parallel also to the great wedding feast of the Lamb, in which God invites all the world to join with him at this great celebration of the union of the church with its head. And it's quite evident that there will be many also who show great indifference to this, will make excuses, will perhaps neglect even their own well-being and their salvation, though their names may be in the king's book, because
is talking about inviting guests, you know, in the story. So apparently, just because your name is in the book doesn't mean you're going to make it. Names can be blotted out and people removed from the list if they show great indifference or disregard for the king. And again, in at least the parallel account, the excuses that were offered were comprised of nothing that necessarily wrong or immoral. You know, I'm sorry I can't come to the wedding. That's usually the time when I'm on the internet looking at porn. I mean, no. It was nothing like that. It was just stuff, just ordinary stuff. So occupied with the activities of life that the king's invitation seemed intrusive and burdensome. And I think we realize that the same temptation dogs us daily. We put so many things ahead of God each day, and as terrible as it sounds to say out loud, we force the Almighty King, the Lord God, into the position of having to compete for our attention on a daily basis against the whole world of distractions. What will become of our poor souls if they remain simply too busy to notice God or to accept His final invitation? Well, I suggest that we not find that out, but instead I think that we can turn to God more and give Him greater honor when we pay more attention, especially to the little things in life. You know, there used to be an old song, "Little things mean a lot," and that's really true when it comes even to the Christian life. We all struggle with so many big things in our life, but those things are easier to address if we pay attention to little things first. I think what I'm talking about are the little choices that we make each day, sometimes each hour, that often seem so inconsequential at the time, but which in fact add up to become the pattern of our life. We're always making little choices against God, and that just becomes a lifestyle against God, you know. Taking, for example, prayer. You know, we all struggle with prayer. We all struggle with keeping a rule of prayer. I mean, I often say I've never had anybody come to confession saying, "Father, I can't stop praying. You know, should I reduce my rule to 12 hours? No. Even if your rule is 5 minutes, we know how hard it is to keep. You walk past your prayer corner in the morning, averting your eyes, as if I don't see it, it won't see me. Or we go to pray, and just like that, are turned aside because we think of something we need to do. Oh, yeah, I got to go clean the garage, or whatever. Of course, if you have kids, it's really easy to be distracted, but that's not your fault. It's that we really just don't like to pray, and we will put anything between us and prayer. I refer to it as the tissue curtain, you know, that anybody could just tear aside. But most of the time, it's enough to keep us away. That we don't want to pray. We don't want to pray. We have to force ourselves to pray, for the most part. This is the reason why we don't pray. For such a simple thing, prayer is disproportionately marred. And this, you know, is perhaps because prayer is the lifeblood of our communion with God, and therefore a major focus of the devil's war against us. He doesn't want us to pray, so he will use our own laziness, our own passions against us, and our ability to be distracted. We wrestle against spiritual foes who will stop at nothing to stall or prevent prayer. And to be honest, we are pretty easily stopped. So, a little thing. Fight back. Fight to pray. Don't believe your own excuses. Don't think that, wow, I really need to empty the trash right now. I can't wait 5 minutes from now. It's only half full, but you know, I just don't like to see trash in the house. Whatever. You know, we make the flimsiest excuses. Fight back. Don't believe it. Don't listen to yourself. Take that little 5 minutes of prayer. Because 5 minutes of prayer, hard fought and hard won, each day will set our lives on course to God that yields big results for us. You see what I'm getting at? If we win every day, even if it's only 5 minutes of prayer, what is that? It's a little thing. But if we win every day, that's something. That's something very big. That's a direction. Just as if we lose every day, that's also something very big. And that direction. I think there's other little things that we can think about to do. You know, when we come to church, we all need to make an effort to come prepared. Not just with nice clothes and polished shoes and that sort of thing, but spiritually prepared. Of course, that would include things like attending great vespers the night before. You know, of course, that the whole thing is tied together, that in the ancient church, that's what they did. They started liturgy at about, midnight? They would come together to pray and pray through the evening and then take communion on Sunday morning and go to work, because Sunday was just a regular day. So we have sort of vestual images of that in our great vesper service. We want to try to keep that in some degree, understanding the history. Saturday night should not be like, I don't know what. Saturday night's all right for fighting, or Nails and John. But, you know, I mean, I'll be quiet as much as we can. I mean, it's not to say you can't go out and have a beer, you know, but some people really abuse their freedom. And I think we don't want to be legalistic, but we want to pay attention to the little things. Come to the vespers, if at all possible. And if you can't come to vespers, you know, the church says you're supposed to pray the prayers at home, so that you're united to your brethren who are in church praying. It's just not our free time to do it with as we will. We should be connected to the church. Those little things really matter. And after vespers, to be kind of quiet, spend it, you know, with your family, what have you. We should also come to Matins.
Excuse me.
Come to Matins. That is also a time of continued preparations. It's in that cycle of prayer. Now, of course, you know, people with little kids will absolutely lose their minds if they spend 2.5 hours in church. That's, you know, I'm not talking to you. You don't need to feel guilty. If you've got a recalcitrant spouse and he only lets you come to liturgy, that's, you know, I understand. But for the rest of us, those of us whose kids are 25 or what have you, we have no excuse. We need to be in Mass. But Sunday's the only day I get to sleep in. I don't care. Come to Mass. You're worshiping God. This is part of your life. This is part of the sacrifice that you make. And did you know, even when you come to Mass, there are times that are set aside for us to be especially reverent. You may not know this, but, for example, during the reading of the 6 Psalms, which occurs early in Mass, there's supposed to be no movement in the church, except for the priest who comes out to pray for all of those present during that time. Nobody, you shouldn't be out lighting candles, you shouldn't be walking around, you should be standing in place during those 6 Psalms. Why? Because those 6 Psalms, according to the tradition, are what your angel will recite to you as your soul is awaiting judgment. Wow. And they are psalms of comfort, of God's love, of God's, you know, commitment to his people, to you. Psalms also speaking of the judgment of God, but of his mercy. And we are standing there, in a sense, a prequel to our judgment. This is why we don't move around. This is why we don't talk. This is why we don't light candles or distract ourselves. We stand there and we think about standing beside our angel one day. You should, you know, people in some churches, they won't even let you come in during the reading of the 6 Psalms. You have to. So you think about it, you realize, well, there's a whole level of reverence here that a lot of us are not even aware of what goes on in the church and how important it is and how all these pieces fit together to bring us to God. should make our convenience a higher priority than reverence. We should be a church. And even when we come into church, we ought to take the time to enter the church properly. Now, you know, at the narthex, of course, we come in, we should be quiet. No loud talking, no laughing in the narthex. Venerating the icons, saying the prayers, and entering in the church quietly. When we come into the church, actually through the doors, we should face the altar and the icons and say the prayers of entry into a church, which are in your prayer book. In other words, we don't just walk in like this is any other room in the world. You can always forgive me, but we can always tell when we have Protestant, like evangelical friends and relatives visiting, like during baptisms, because it's really noisy in here. Why? Because they have never learned about sacred spaces, about how you treat the house of God with reverence. They just, you know, to them it's just a building. You know, they believe that what they do is good and worshipful, but the building itself is just a building. And so they don't have any concept of sacred space and reverence. But we Orthodox are supposed to be better than that, or however you want to describe it. We are supposed to know that when we come into God's house, this is a place that is set apart, sanctified, sacred. We don't carry on like it's any other room. We don't laugh and joke. We come in prayerfully. We leave prayerfully. You're supposed to make the sign of the cross or the altar before you go out. We have the prayers afterwards of after communion, which is a convenience, it's a service, because we should be praying those prayers after we receive communion to give thanks to God for what we've just received. We don't just take it like, you know, a cheeseburger and gulp it down and move on, go on to our next thing. We prepare ourselves before we take communion, and we give thanks to God after we take communion. But for a lot of people, and especially, you know, the kids, I understand you gotta get out, gotta get out of coffee hour. But it's like as soon as people get out that door, it's noise out there. And every time the door swings open, noise. And people are in there trying to pray. We should be quiet. An architect should not be a place of fellowship. That's what the fellowship hall is for. Go in there, you deserve a break. Cut loose. You know, throw coffee around. Do what you do. Have a good time. But in the narthex, coming, going, quiet, reverent, prayerful. Find out the prayers. Use the prayers. It will start to change your life. Little things that will set you on a different course. It will make you appreciate more the presence of God in our lives, not just in church, but every day in our lives. Same thing when you pray before your meals. You should always pray before every meal. Why? Because you are asking God to bless your food. Why would you want to eat unblessed food? You know, I mean, we're asking God, what does it mean when God blesses your food? It means he's blessing it for your body, for your use, for your nutrition, for your health. You don't believe that? Then don't pray. But if you do believe that, you should pray. We shouldn't just wolf down food like dogs. We just put it in front of us. I got that from some story I heard about a kid, a Christian kid, that went to have dinner at a friend's house, and the friends weren't Christians. Dinner was served, and they all started eating, and the kid was shocked. You mean you all just start eating like dogs? You know, you don't pray first? Okay, it's out of the mouth of babes, you know. Well, we don't want to act that way. We do want to pray and give thanks to God and ask him. Yes, you know, we're not secular people. We believe that that prayer makes a difference, that God is actually actively changing our food with his blessing, with his grace. So that's what we do. We should, oh, by the way, I should probably mention that if we accept our daily bread without reverence, without thanking God, without asking him to bless it, if we just eat like dogs, if you take your daily bread that way, without reverence, I guarantee you, you will take divine bread without reverence. You will treat communion as if it were just another snack. Until we really learn to be grateful for our daily bread, it is hard for us to grasp or understand what we're doing when we take communion. communion, and that's a fact. And speaking of bread, we should also try to keep the fasts if we are physically able to. Old folks, sick folks, you know, you're off the hook. Although you can still maybe come up with something that you can do. But we have to remember why fasting is important, because the church hates us. No, that's not why. It's because Jesus sanctified fasting as a means for us to overcome the deceptions of the devil and to weaken the fleshly passions. That's why he fasted for 40 days and then confronted the devil and put him to shame. And we needed that. Otherwise, we would be at the mercy of the devil. We would not be able to stand against him. We would not be able to overcome the temptations to love the whole world as he offered, or the whole kingdoms, or all the wealth. Jesus sang, just like he does everything, nothing is just symbolic. Everything means something. He was baptized so that our baptism becomes a new birth. And he fasted so that we can overcome the devil and the temptations. If you don't fast, then don't wonder why you're still beat up all the time and why you have all these lusts and problems and difficulties. Fast. It's important. It's more than just me want a cheeseburger, you know, and we make a little choice and we say, what difference does it make if I have a piece of cheese? Well, it's a little thing, isn't it? But it's an important thing. If you have a piece of cheese, of course you can. But you might be better off if you fast. And I think you would. And that's a fact, too. Part of the problem with many of the so-called little choices we make each day is that we don't really understand the repercussions, the lingering effects. If we choose faithfulness, we draw closer to God, even if it's only 5 minutes of prayer or taking care to enter the church properly. We choose poorly, choose selfishly, choose inattentively, as if our choices really didn't matter, and we grow that much duller in spirit. Or God. So many other things that we could mention, we could talk about, but I won't get into those because I think I've talked too long already. But it's good for us to form a habit of thinking about our daily choices, those little things. Sometimes those little things that we feel kind of guilty, should I do this, you know? Well, let's all pay more attention to those things, because it turns out they might matter a lot more than we realize. And also remember that we have been invited to a great heavenly banquet, an eternal bliss. Let us not be found unworthy, because that is possible. It's not a shoo-in. If we show that we have no regard for God and no interest in his Son, then why would he open his gates to us? Paying closer attention to the little things to increase our devotion and obedience to God will bring us great rejoicing. Not bitter shame. To the glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and save us, O God, by thy grace, wisdom.
That is guarded always by the mighty and ascribed glory unto thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Now and ever and unto ages of ages.
remember his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. President of the United States and all civil authorities and our armed forces everywhere, the Lord God remember that of his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Over the Orthodox servants of God, recorded this, especially for the priest Wayne, for Donald, Wanda, Alexander, John, William, Maximus, Basil, Emily, Peter, and Alex, for Richard and Cheryl, for Stella and her family, Max, Emily, Destiny, Colleen and her family, for Anna, Nadia, Angela, and Destiny. The Lord God, remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, especially for Kevin and for Dean, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Let the whole day be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless. Let us ask of the Lord.
Grant this, O Lord.
An angel of peace, a faithful guide, guardian of our souls and bodies, let us ask of the Lord.
Grant this, O Lord.
Grant the remission of our sins and transgressions, all things good and profitable for our souls, and for peace in the world, let us ask of the Lord.
Grant this, O Lord.
That we may complete the remaining time of our life in peace.
peace and repentance, for a Christian ending to our life, painless, blameless, peaceful, and a good defense before the awesome judgment seat of Christ, let us ask of the Lord. Remembrance are all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints. Let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God. That with one accord we may confess.
Existing and eternally the same, thou and thy only begotten Son and thy Holy Spirit.
how it was who has bring us from non-existence into being. And when we have fallen away, has raised us up again, and has not ceased to do all things, so the love has brought us back to heaven, and has endowed us with thy kingdom which is to come. For all these things we give thanks unto thee and for thine only begotten Son and thy Holy Spirit. For all things of which we know and of which we know not, and for all the benefits bestowed upon us, both manifest and unseen. And we give thanks to thee also for this ministry, which thou hast vouchsafed to receive at our hands, even though there stand beside thee thousands of archangels and ten thousands of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six-winged, many eyes, soaring aloft toward other kingdoms, singing the triumphal hymn, shall be proclaiming and saying, the grave, the resurrection on the third day, the ascension into heaven, the session at the right hand, and the second and glorious advent. Thine own of thine own we offer unto thee in behalf of all and for all.
Oh,
sick, the suffering, captives, and their salvation. Be mindful, O Lord, of those who bear fruit and do good works in thy holy churches, and who remember the poor, and upon us all send forth thy mercies. And grant us with one mouth and one heart to glorify and praise thy all honorable and majestic name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Mercies of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all.
Thank you.
Fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.
Christ, for the remission of sins.
Thank you.
divine, holy, immaculate, immortal, heavenly, life-giving, and awesome mysteries of Christ, let us worthily give thanks unto the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Asking that the whole day may be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Make straight our path, establish all of us in thy fear, guard our life, make firm our steps, through the prayers and intercessions of the glorious Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary our Father's. For thou art our sanctification, and unto thee we ascribe glory, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Trust in thee, save thy people, and bless thine inheritance. Preserve the fullness of thy church, sanctify those who love the beauty of thy house, glorify them and recompense by thy divine power, and forsake us not who hope on thee. Give peace to thy world, to thy churches, to the priests, to all civil authorities, to our armed forces, and to all thy people. For every good and perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from thee, the Father of lights. And unto thee we ascribe glory, thanksgiving, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
And all honorable apostles, of the holy, glorious, and right victorious martyrs,
of our venerable and God-bearing fathers, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the martyr Malmas and his family, and John the Faster, Patriarch of Constantinople, and of all the saints, have mercy upon us and save us, for as much as he is good and loves mankind. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us.
Amen.